So here is a question, right? Input G, output is an integer, which is the number of spanning trees of G. Again, I am not going to do this. There is a theorem called the Kirchhoff's theorem. Okay. So the next theme that I want to kind of, which is like a puzzle, is forbidden subgraphs. So what I want to do is, I want to construct graphs which have some geometric meaning, right? So in particular, I want to, for example, construct graphs of, let us say, so I have all these circular disks. Right, and so on. So input consists of all these kinds of disks, right? Corresponding to this structure, I want to draw the following graph, which is to have one vertex for each of these disks. How many disks are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, right? Right. So 1 and 2 are adjacent because they have a non-empty intersection, right? 2 and 3, right, are adjacent because they have a non-empty intersection, right? 3 and 4 intersect, 3 and 5 intersect, right? 3 and 6 also have an intersection, right? And so on, right? So 4 and 5 also intersect, right? And 6 and 5 intersect. I think I have got all the intersections via adjacencies, right? Fine. So in a sense, this graph has some geometric meaning, right? So now the question is the following. Is every graph the intersection graph of disks like this? Or are there graphs which are not intersections of disks of this form? So before we go to disks, let's do something even more simpler, right? I have intervals. So these are all intervals of the real line, okay? Some interval is contained inside here. This is an interval 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 here, and so on. Exactly like I did this for disks, I'm going to take these intervals and I'm going to construct a graph. For every interval, I'm going to put one vertex. Right, and put an edge if two intervals have a non-empty intersection, right? Okay. So now here is a question. For these intervals, are there graphs which are forbidden? Meaning that you can immediately see that a certain graph cannot be expressed as the intersections of intervals. Oh, that, no, that won't be, no. This is very easy. I just put an edge. If the two intervals are intersecting like this, that's also an edge. Right? So this is interval A, this is interval B, this is A, B. Right? This is the vertex for interval A, this is the vertex for interval B. So vertex for interval A, this is the vertex for interval B. Okay, so let me give you example graphs, right? Take this graph. Can you give me intervals, right, whose intersection gives me this graph? We did that for an edge. So here the example is very easy. Maybe something that looks like this. Right? There are many ways of drawing it. Some one of you might have even drawn it like this, right? So I mean, a single graph has so many geometric realizations, right? So for example, these two are very different geometric realizations. Okay, now let's look at one more graph like this. Right. So now what do? So I must give intervals to all these guys, right? A, B, C, and D. Right. So what will I do? I'll basically make an interval B like this. Right. I'll make C contained here, and then D will be like this, right? And then I will make A adjacent to B and C. As you can see, I have ensured that A and D are not adjacent, right? But everybody else is kind of adjacent, right? So do you think for every graph this is possible? Remember, this is time, right? It's always strictly increasing in one direction. That's a hint. Here is it. That's very easy. It's exactly like this. Let's try this guy. Take this graph. Can you give me four intervals which will give me exactly this graph? Okay, this is the first interval. Which one? Okay. Oh, this is A. Okay. You can't, right? Do you have a reason why you can't? Yeah, so in some sense, so you try this, right? If somebody claims he has, you start this. Okay, so A is here, B is, okay, let us say it is like this, right? See, B can't be contained inside C, no? Sorry, B can't be contained inside A. Then you will be in trouble, because when you add C to be adjacent to B, then you will have to put in the edge AC. So B should be in such a way that it has some space which is disjoint from A, right? So now you take C. So clearly C should not intersect with A, so somewhere you will, if you put C here, then when D becomes adjacent to C, you'll have to put the edge DB, right? So therefore C can't be like this. It can't be contained inside the interval for B, right? It has to like go out like this. Fine. So now if you add D only here, you cannot make it adjacent to A because it's an interval, right? If you try to kind of force it and make it adjacent like this, it becomes adjacent to everything else, right? Therefore, this graph, right, is a forbidden structure for interval graphs, right? So that's why I said, if you start drawing this, you will kind of observe that these are actually behaving like time. Every interval has a right endpoint which is larger than the right endpoint of the previous interval, right? And then if you try to make it adjacent somewhere to the first interval, then you will make all kinds of adjacencies. But if I ask you to put this adjacency, then it is easy. Right? That's what we had done first. Fine. But if you remove that single edge, that is if you remove this, right, this is hard. If you put any one, then we did create it. So this guy is one. Right? Okay. The story doesn't end there. Is this all, or can you come up with one more? For example, take a look at this guy. Can you give intervals to these seven vertices such that you get exactly this graph? Okay, so let us start. Which vertex? This vertex is the kind of problem you're thinking, right? So let us see, right? So let us draw this guy. Right? So these guys are pointing out something that if you try to give an interval to this central vertex, right? So let's give names as usual: A, B, C, D, E, F, and G. Right? So if you give this guy A. Now observe that any of these intersections cannot be a containment. For example, if B is here, right? Now when you make C adjacent to B, then you will form a triangle. That's not nice, right? So therefore, you're forced to make B like this, right? And then you're forced to make C like this, right? Similarly, with respect to A, the same thing you have to do with F and G, right? So F will be something like this and G will be something like this. Then there is absolutely no space for you to put D and E. The only way you can do is you can just put D alone here. You can't put an E anymore. Right? So this world of forbidden structures is very, very interesting. Right? So if you go around, there is this whole subject called discrete geometry. Right? And one of the ways of studying this is to construct these graphs which capture the intersection. And you can study this, and most probably when Professor Sunil Chandran comes and gives a talk, he will talk about these graphs, right? But there is a puzzle, there is a programming exercise that I can give you here, right? So you have classes, right? Or rather, lectures in time slots. Right? So for example, you have lectures, right, at different time slots throughout the day. Right? The duration of the lectures you don't know, but the time slots are there. Therefore, every lecture is kind of an interval. Right? So select maximum number of So what I have done is I have already given you one application to think of these interval graphs. So how would you do this? Any idea? So you can think of some hack or a heuristic which will give you the maximum. Or can you do this optimally? You want to say something? Huh? It says maximum matching or something else? Why is it matching? No, these are not edges. No, the time slots. So if you model it as a graph, you have to model it a bit more carefully, right? So you have these lectures. Lectures are just time slots. Try to pick as many disjoint time slots as possible. Yeah, so one way of modeling it is that you represent these as intervals, and today morning, if you notice, we studied about a set of vertices inside which there are no edges at all. That's called an independent set, right? So this is selecting a maximum independent set. Okay, my interest is not to give you a solution. All that I am telling you is that, I mean, you look at these interval graphs or geometric graphs, right? So there are immediate applications, right, that you can look for and design algorithms, right? So especially with disk graphs and placement of wireless towers without interference, right? All these are very, very interesting exercises, right? So let me ask you about one more forbidden structure, right? And then we'll stop with that. So how many of you have seen planar embeddings or planar graphs? You've seen planar graphs? No? Okay, so these are graphs that can be drawn on the plane without edges crossing except at their endpoints. Right? So for example, let's look at this graph. It's already a planar graph the way I drew it. Right? This is also a planar graph the way I have drawn it, right? It's drawn on the plane, right? No edges cross. If two edges ever meet, they meet only at their endpoints, right? But now if I wanted to draw this edge, how would I do this? I kind of have to create a, right? I have to do something like this, right? So this is a planar embedding. So, do you know of graphs which don't have a planar embedding? Okay, Peterson graph doesn't have a planar embedding. Okay, and why doesn't it have a planar embedding? I see. Okay, so she says that this graph is a graph that does not have a planar embedding. I'm correct, no? This is the graph, right? Right? Is there any specific reason, right, why this graph does not have a planar embedding? You know, in a sense, what would be the smallest graph which doesn't have a planar embedding? Is this the smallest graph? I mean, is this the one with the least number of vertices, or is there something smaller? Yeah, complete graph with 5 vertices, right? So then. Am I done? Okay. Right. And obviously, this edge I simply can't draw at all without crossing these two. Another graph. C phi is planar. The way you draw it itself is planar. On either side, 3 and 3, is it? Okay, but 2 and 2 you can draw, right? Or 2 and 3 also you can draw? Yeah, so for example, if you look at the complete bipartite graph, now I'm in trouble. I simply can't draw this edge, right? So this has 6 vertices and this has 10 vertices, right? And both of them look very different, right? But the Peterson graph, does it contain any of these two structures inside it? Yeah, so I guess this is not an easy thing, right, to be done very quickly, right? So apparently that you can get all the forbidden structures from these two graphs, right? In other words, if you edge subdivide any of these guys, this is also not planar. That is, right, so you have this one more edge. Take 8 subdivisions, right, of these two graphs, they are also not planar. And there is a very nice theorem called the Kuratowski's theorem that you should go and take a look at. So we started off with coloring. So let me just show you one very interesting. This is the last one, we'll stop with this. So recall what we started off with, right? So we started off with some coloring problems and I introduced intervals to you, right? So what you should do is you should color the intervals such that no two overlapping intervals get the same color, right? Intersecting intervals, different colors. Do you know why this would be an interesting question? Why would anybody think of such a problem? Any ideas? Why, what would be a practical application where you have these intervals and you want to allocate colors to these intervals, and when two intervals are intersecting, they should not have the same color? Okay, interval schedule is in one. So I'm sure if you study your compilers, right, subsequently, or if you've already studied it, a very popular problem called register allocation. Right. So remember that your compiler takes your program and allocates to every variable, right, a memory location, and then when that variable participates in some instructions, right, it allocates a register also. Right. Now, if two variables have the same scope, right, then they can't be given the same register. Right? So for example, if you have a piece of code which is like this, and you have int A, right, and you have character B, right, even though they are of different types, right, inside the scope, you can't give the same register to keep the value of A and B. So, the interval coloring models the lifetime of a variable as an interval. What does the interval look like? This, so when I draw the interval like this, you get the imagination of time, right? But when I draw the interval like this, right, you get an imagination of the scope of a particular variable name, right? So normally for most programming languages, the scope is always nested, right? You may not have, right, and a scope which is overlapping like this, fine, okay. So therefore, in a sense, we are considering a slightly more general problem when we consider interval coloring than register allocation, fine, okay. Okay, so now here is the puzzle. If I give you a set of intervals, how many colors are required? You can even try this example, right? So you give this red, this guy is intersecting, you'll give it blue, and this guy, well, you can reuse red, right? You can reuse blue, right? You can reuse red, but you can't use blue because, right? So you have to introduce a color called green, right? Now this one, you can probably give blue or green, but I'll just give blue, right? I can give red again, and I give green, right? So my question to you is, how many colors are required? Maximum overlapping set, that's correct, right? So what he basically says is, look at all the time instances, look at that time instant which is present to the maximum number of intervals, right? And that many colors is necessary, right? So it is at least, right, max over all time instances I such that T is an I. Right? Look at every time instant, 0 to infinity or whatever, right? At consider all the intervals such that T is an I. That many colors you need definitely because they all overlap. So it's at least, but why is it equal? Because you said equal, right? Okay, I'll stop by leaving it as an exercise. It's very easy. I mean, if you got this far, that's also very easy. Order intervals. And if you just spend some time thinking about it, you will prove that you will use exactly so many colors and no more. So the algorithm is very simple, or it's a constructive proof. You can convert it into a program. Linearly order all the intervals. Right? How do you linearly order them? You sort them according to your left endpoint and arrange them one after the other. Right? So whenever you consider an interval, all the intervals which started before it have already been given colors. Only this guy you must color. You just color it greedily. Meaning what? If you can reuse any color which you have already used, use it without violating the coloring property. Right? And this is one of a special class of combinatorial structures where coloring works very efficiently. In general, it's not known to be efficiently solved. Okay. So with this, I will stop. So let me just summarize. Right? We studied coloring. And we studied forbidden structures, right? So for example, one of the things I wanted to do was I wanted to write a small proof that planar graphs are, you know, it is, they are 4 colorable, right? It's a very popular result, right? But planar graphs are 5 colorable is very easily provable. I want to do that, but I think you can fix it by yourself, right? If you just study it a little bit, there's a formula called the Euler's formula for planar graphs. Apply the Euler's formula, you can argue that planar graphs are 5 colorable.